basically if we have just two-dimensional aggregates, in this case, there's low activity, there's an optimum size in an intermediate range, and this is the number of atoms per ion. And if you go to large aggregates, you have a low activity in this case. So the fact that there is size sensitivity would require an optimum particle size distribution. And again, we're going in the direction of synchronous dispersions. So why is there a synchronous dispersion? Basically, what we have is when we prepare materials, they are in the metal stage. And once a new environment is set, that's primarily through temperature changes, but also through changes in the atmosphere, it is possible that the system will relax into new structures. In this case, I'm using a thermodynamic process. That's basically correct, even if you're not using this continuum thermodynamics. You need to calculate the free energy of the system, and then you will have a decay that in many cases will be similar, irrespective of whether you start from a monomodal distribution of low small crystallites, or even if you start from a field. There's a tendency to go towards an intermediate direction. So what are the experimental observations? Primarily that if you do kinetics, you will have fast initial agglomeration of these metallic crystallites. And then there will be a slowing down of the process and an essentially constant dispersion may be reached, or frequently dispersed. I can agree that in some cases it is not. Now the particle size distributions in general are not normal. That's an observation that actually Biodatum will be talking about today. And there are support and atmosphere effects depending on how you treat the material, we get different results. And in this case, initial conditions frequently matter as to what you will have at the end. Now, how have we come about analyzing crystalline sintering? Normally, we've done it through sintering kinetics. And in that general way of doing that is through power law equations. That was the first approach. And they were fitted to kinetic predictions using models that we discussed about that, and normally they were inadequate. And in the case of the common size distribution used, that is the Osborne model, there is a problem with the predictions. Definitely they don't perform the predictions. So some years ago, I was trying to analyze some results that we had in the laboratory. And I came up with an observation that is very simple. Mainly it has to do with the fact that you do have stationary distributions when you do sintering. And this is a very long experiment that was done by Wayne Champagne and Dashan Liu. And they went up to 1,000 hours, and they actually observed that there was a limiting distribution in the decay. So in this case, platinum aluminum. But also if you start from a film, as I was mentioning, you go in the direction of platinum distribution. So after chronic treatments, stationary distributions are okay. And that was the basis of introducing a very simple change in the standard power law equation. And that's basically the use of the stationary dispersion. This is a rather simple idea. It actually became powerful in order to get some really order into the structure of sintering analysis. Basically, if you go into the power law equation order of sintering, you will see that it is frequently a function of time. It depends on the amount of number of data also of the temperature. And so that was not satisfactory. Here I'm presenting results by Richardson and Trump. They used in their original study anybody for century. In this case, I'm going back to Naples. This is the type of decay that you have. In this case, I must stress that this is the limiting dispersion that you're getting. So there is a sigmoidal decay as a function of temperature, and in principle, we have a complete indication of what's going on. And here, I also wanted to show that there is a difference. There is sensitivity to the type of material that one uses. In this case, it's silica. This one is aluminum. And you can tell that there are differences in what I'm calling the distribution of stability for so this is also a nice result trying to show that there is a difference, and as far as I remember, this is work by Cabra-Flavin. Now, so to summarize what we have to do, what is my revelation? Well, consistent equation for dealing with kinetics is a generalized model equation. Normally, the order is 1, 2. There is an explanation for having order 2 in this case that, in my opinion, has to do more with the kinetic disguise. The combination of power first order processes, some very fast, some very slow. Eventually, you will get like in cracking kinetics, a second order process. So that's one idea that I set forth for explaining why in some cases the order will be 2. Now, this limiting dispersion has a sigmoidal dependence on temperature. And it is not an equilibrium value in the sense of the reaction. I have a few discussions with some people concerning that. And actually, I've gone back to trying to analyze what is really the idea of physics. And going back to the physics of the process, and I insist that this is a physics problem, not a chemistry problem like the discussion we had once. It so happens that you can have this type of dependence in essentially irreversible processes that lead into a stationary state. And that's the whole idea of having this disorder. So now what was the next step? We have an equation that works very nicely. Is there any fundamental background into that? Is there a model that can explain that? At the time, we analyzed the different models that were available. And obviously, they were agreeing with what we were seeing, because the models didn't have cell into the structure, the possibility of having a stationary value. So, what are these models? And you may know this is a crystalline migration model. Everything is moving on the surface. In principle, that's in theory what should happen. The surface, this is not a totally correct representation of that. It's an animated cartoon. That's what we have. Tell you that basically everything moves, and then at the end you will have agglomeration. In this case, that's all what we're adding to the system. This is the classical, one of the classical models in a catalyst syndrome. And it comes from the work by Rubinstein a number of years ago, in 1976, I guess. And what they did is they solved numerically the Smoluchowski equation. And this is the Smoluchowski equation. I will show that this is a restricted equation at this point, because this only has a population, it only has 10, and we have a growth under all conditions. Now, the results of Rubinstein were very interesting, and at the time they kind of set up the idea of what should one do when dealing with syndrome. And that is to use the Pavlov equation and get orders, depending on the order that you get, you will say that diffusion control or particle coalescence control, depending on the range of order that the Now we decided to grow further and see if we could justify the generalized power equation. Is there a reason for having stationary value, stationary distribution? And indeed, one can do it. If we just go into generalized Smoluchowski equation, you have both a population and fragmentation terms. So we have a fragmentation terms. not familiar with the experiments. However, we found that there's really a family of solutions, of which a telescope is just one of the solutions. And we found that family of solutions. And here, what I'm presenting is the classical LSW solution. This is in Spanish. And then what I'm presenting is just one of the solutions that you can get. And that's basically a log normal particle size distribution. And we'll discuss about that further on this afternoon. I also wanted to do some Monte Carlo simulation just to see whether we could students that have sometimes worked into this. I want to thank Juan Estabalab, and I want to mention something that I was saying. This research was not supported by any other thing that our desire to work in this direction. It's a very interesting field, and unfortunately there are no significant funding available, at least not in Mexico, for this type of research. But I found it very interesting and intellectually stimulating. And this is just an overview of what we've seen. This another
BYU. Gustavo, there are some crystallite size distribution data from TEM. We've published some. I think that Richardson has published some. Have you been analyzed the model, you know, analyzed these data in terms of your model?
Actually, we've done, I didn't present that. We haven't really gone through all the literature because this is just a side area right now for us. But with the limited amount of results that we have seen, we could actually fit those results quite nicely. See, I emphasize the normal distribution as one part of observed distribution, but in principle, you can change the shape of the distribution depending on the parameters. Now, there's a fundamental problem there. One has to be careful because if you just use them as a fitting parameter, then you may run against the physics of the problem. But if you're consistent in the way you approach that, then you can actually adjust nicely the particle size distributions with either one of the systems if it's relatively simple. And as to what mechanism, if you will, is prevalent, my opinion is that they are basically the same. Fundamentally, there is no significant difference at a very fundamental level in both processes. So, adapter migration may be prevalent under some conditions. And if you go high enough in temperature, you will have the larger crystallites also showing movement. But that also, the adaptive migration will be occurring under those conditions. So there is no reason to make a significant difference. You cannot tell the difference from our research.
Sure.
Yeah, very interesting part of this history. One question I have is in redispersion. In redispersion, I would expect the power dependency would be different from, I mean, inversely proportional to the dispersion with time, because we found that the power dependency on the dispersion redispersion rate is inversely proportional to the dispersion of the iridium on the surface is to the second power. You know, so because what you are doing is if you redisperse it, then the agglomerate particle surface area is decreasing, and you know, so your rate will be lower
as you redisperse the agglomerate particle.
I'm sorry, the rate will be lower as the
redispersion increase. The redispersion rate will be lower as the redispersion as the dispersion increase.
Yeah.
I agree. Is it worse?
No, what you will see is actually the opposite direction.
The
dispersion will increase and then level off.
Yeah. So the order is not positive.
No, but in this case, it really depends on how you deal with the. Okay, I see what you mean. Yeah, I think we could discuss that, but it really depends on what you're plotting under those conditions. But you will see an increase in dispersion, and you will get the same sort of functionality. I think,
Oh, this is very interesting work, and what you are arguing is that really there are not two mechanisms. There's only one process, and you really shouldn't make a distinction. But mechanistically, it appears that the movement of single atoms and the movement of large particles, they should be mechanistically very different. I wonder what your comments are. In all of your observations, you reach a limiting dispersion with long time. What is the reason why you reach a limiting dispersion for these two mechanisms? They should be very different.
Okay. Yeah, I think that the basics are the same. We have to remember, however, that in this case, we're using models that don't include mental support interactions. So actually, they will float support. And there is this size dependency that you introduce into dispersion or diffusion that can be used to take into account the fact that larger particles will diffuse much slower. So I think we're still far from the point where we can have a well-defined metal support interaction, and that's a direction we're interested in pursuing. In terms of the, let's see, your second comment, I think it has to do with thermodynamics. If I go to the physicist's explanation of statistical mechanics, basically you have detailed balance if you use Molyneux's equation, and then you balance the processes going in one direction and the other, and you reach a stable distribution. If we think in terms of thermodynamics, you're reaching a minimum surface free energy.
What you find is you reach a limiting dispersion at a given temperature. And you raise the temperature, and it centers further.
Yeah.
So you're saying that thermodynamics will explain this enhanced center.
Let me remember if I have the information. Yeah, because thermodynamics will in the case, depends on the way you model the system in terms of the surface available. So if you account for that, yes, I think you can deal with it. I've seen more and more models that are being used to explain distributions using switching between minima in surface free energy, even reaccommodation of structures in particles. So it seems that it goes in that direction.
And surface energy depending on the temperature?
Surface energy, well, it has a temperature dependence, but also depends on the surface of it. And that's really the one point to consider.
Yes, Gustavo, I have a problem with the fundamentals of the redispersion mechanism. What is the thermodynamic term which could explain this redispersion? Because there should be some free energy term which permits that.
It's just a regular surface free energy. What I'm saying is the following. If you go in one atmosphere at a certain temperature and you put you define your system in thermodynamics, and you change the conditions of the catalyst that is really unstable.
Yes, when you change the condition, I agree. But when you have a constant conditions, how could this occur?
Under constant conditions, unless I misunderstood, you could not redisperse. You have to change the atmosphere, as an example. If you put oxygen or water or chlorinated compounds, then you will start creating, you are actually changing the system. And you would have a different meaning. So it's possible under some conditions, and that's a trick, to have a different minimum free energy, and then the system will go in that direction. So it's like as if it were going upwards against thermodynamics, but no, because you change the system. You're not comparing the same systems if you change the atmosphere.
But you have to allow metal support interaction.
Yeah.
But you have to allow metal support.
things have been asked. I like the lecture very much. But one thing, in real life, you usually want to decrease dispersion. You want to increase dispersion, so you do not want all your phenomena. And you could add them promoters, let's say, structural promoters. In your view, is there space for, let's say, structural promoters where you block the loss of dispersion? Could you model that also, or is that too far away?
The only way would be to modify the kernels of the system. In this type of equations, we don't have a way to introduce yet metal support interaction. At least we haven't realized how to do it. So the addition of promoters would imply we could deal with that just by modifying the kinetic constants. Process if we're using Smoluchowski equation, or by modifying the Gibbs-Thompson equation in terms of the free energy involved in Gibbs-Thompson, then by that modifying the whole distribution, it can be done.
So you would then indeed choose to change the surface, huh? Let's say hills and valleys or blocks. Yeah. It would be quite interesting to do that.
Yeah. Question back here. Yes.
Did you observe the fragmentation in your experiment, or you just use that as a mathematical treatment about the fragmentation? Do you have any experimental evidence to see the breakdown of the big particles small, or just
no,
mathematical imagination?
We're not doing those experiments, but I've seen evidence that there is fragmentation under some conditions. Basically, it depends on how mobile the species are and how large the particles are, where you can have more than one, let's say fragmentation would probably involve more than one atom popping off the crystals. And that, there is indication of migration of more than one atom in these sintering conditions. Experimentally, we really are not doing experiments. Would be interesting, and I hope that somebody will make them.
Yes. Roger Gopal from Federal University of Indonesia. Can you comment on whether secondary nucleation or primary nucleation process will have any effect on this synthetic? That means small particles form and they start new sources of.
No, we're.
See, because that will have a similar thing with Oswald Wright.
Let me mention, in principle, yes, if we just consider that in the Smoluchowski approach, you have, amongst other options, the possibility of having two atoms hitting each other and then getting a dimer, that sort of thing. So in that sense, there would be a nucleation. But I don't think that these solutions are valid under conditions of low supersaturation on the surface. And this is a really highly dispersed system. At least the Oswald approach requires that to be straight. So we're not including, as in aerosols, the possibility of having nuclear form under those conditions, have critical nuclear like that.
Just one more comment?
Yes.
See, at least in physical processes, there are two limits of Smoluchowski solutions. One is like threshing and grinding solutions, which are very similar to what you're doing. The other is a crystallization type of solutions, where there is a continuous variation from exponential to log normal distribution.
Mm-hmm.
See, there the nucleation plays a role.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I was wondering.
Yeah, I would agree with
you. Gustavo, I have a final remark. And there is still some difficulty with your asymptotic dispersion. But actually, I don't believe there is a difficulty. We are in statistical thermodynamics, so it's logical that you have in equilibrium with the more stable system, a dispersed, more disordered system in equilibrium. And if you translate the energy of your dispersed particles in terms of chemical potential with the activity and the statistical terms, you believe you end up with this result, that you have a residual dispersed system in any case.
Well, let me tell you something that we're starting to do.